Because I always feel that, you know, with your jacket off and your sleeves folded up, it looks like you actually have done some of the research that you're presenting. But I'm all wired up, so I cannot do that. And maybe that's true, because most of the research I'm presenting is done by my students. As a professor in sustainable product design, I come across a lot of pictures and pictures of products and so on. And of course, I have some favorites. And the next picture I'll show you is one of my favorites. And I want you to take 2 seconds to think what this product actually is. I guess that many of you think this is a waste bin, right? And I think that many people that have seen this also thought it was a waste bin. And they have actually tried to put waste into these openings that were really too small. And they thought, what kind of stupid designer has designed this? Well, actually, this is a ventilation shaft for an underground parking garage. But it makes you think that the design of products, you know, of everyday products, that influences our behavior, influences our relationship with them. Another picture. This is, it's clearly a handrail, right? On a London subway station. But you see what has happened. People have actually, you know, seen it, and they thought, well, you know, it's just big enough to put my cigarette butt in. They actually might have thought it was better to do that than, you know, throw it on the floor. And probably after some people did it, people might actually think, hey, this is the appropriate way of disposing of my cigarette butt. And people might have thought that, you know, this is what it's designed for. You know, when one person starts to do something, it more and more it becomes kind of a value. It becomes a kind of a norm to do it. So that triggers me to think, okay, the design of products, it may allow or even invite unsustainable behavior, undesired behavior, behavior that we don't want in society, for example, because it's unsustainable. So how should we design a waste bin then? You know, should it be this? It's a picture there, it's an icon, and it says, well, you can throw your waste here. It gives you information. It invites you to do that, but nothing more. This is slightly more, you know, inviting. It says, use me. I took this picture when I was in India a couple of weeks ago. It maybe suggests that it has a personal relationship with you. You want to help it, you know, it wants your waste. Then we go a little bit up the scale. This is something that, you know, really invites children to put their waste in there. It's fun. And this is one of my favorite pictures. This is Hollebolle Gijs. Hollebolle Gijs is some kind of a giant. He is famous for being in a Dutch amusement park, the Efteling it's called. And Hollebolle Gijs says every now and then, every minute or so, papier hier, which means paper here, indeed. And kids, they go around, you know, and they try to find waste paper or other stuff, and they put it in. And then it says, thank you. Well, dank je wel in Dutch. And it's funny, because I was showing this presentation yesterday to my daughter when she came down, she couldn't sleep, and she said, what are you doing? I'm making this presentation. And she saw this picture, and she said, I remember that, because we were there, and I was looking around for paper to throw in there, but there wasn't any paper left, because all the kids had taken the paper already and threw it in. So it works. And also for adults, this kind of search. Also for adults, these solutions exist. You might have seen them. I haven't seen them in Norway, actually. But this is a design that invites people in cars or on bicycles to throw their, for example, their I would say beer cans, but you don't have them in cars usually. Some have. To throw them there, you know, and it collects the waste. And actually, you know, it might be that there is some people that are missing, so, but at least, you know, it's close by, and for the people that collect the waste, it's easy to get. So these are fun things, you know. But now if I take a step back and I take a look at, let's say, the more traditional view of eco-design or sustainable product design or design for environment, many terms for that, let's take this life cycle, you know. And I've taken an example of a shirt. You know, usually we see a life cycle from the perspective of raw materials, cotton, making it into parts, you know, fabrics, putting it into product into clothes, shipping it, packaging it, going to retail, it's going to be used, it's going to be stored in some drawer for a while maybe. You know, you wash it, you dry it. Finally, you might recycle it, you might give it to free tax, or you might, you know, throw it away in some other way. And this is the traditional way of looking at eco-design. And then if I add a little bit of eco-design methodology here, which is basically about rules of thumb, you can see some of the guidelines that, let's say, methodology in this field has suggested to deal with reducing the environmental impact of products. And you can see, I'm not going to go all over them, but which is really funny, if you look at the user stage, that's box 5 here, it says something about, okay, we can lower the energy consumption. We've talked a lot about energy. You know, you can try to use maybe clean sources, you know, photovoltaics or wind energy. You know, you can do a lot of things. But this behavioral aspect, this design for sustainable behavior, has been missing. Strange. I blame myself. I mean, I've been around a bit in this field, but it's really since the year 2005 that this starts to get some interest. And now there's a couple of research groups around the world that are looking at it. Because it's not just about technology, about materials. It's about humans. You know, if you do the laundry, for example, let's take that practice. You know, it's not just about reducing the energy consumption of a washing machine. It's about thinking, why do we do the laundry? You know, I'm probably going to throw this shirt tonight in the laundry bin, but, you know, I could hang it out. The weather is nice. It might get fresh. It's a convention that we do this. We're afraid that people smell us when we don't do that. You know, we maybe wash because our mother has taught us to do it like that. You know, we might wash on a specific day using specific products because those are social conventions. And if we rethink that, we might get ideas for trying to design solutions that actually invite for more sustainable behavior. This is an interesting study that marked, let's say, the beginning of this research area. It's a guy called Edward Elias from Bath University, and he looked at refrigerators. He thought, well, there's going to be some improvement potential probably in trying to design a fridge in a way that you don't open the door so much. You know, people do not usually think beforehand what they want, and they know where it is, and then, you know, you open the door, you get it, and you close it, reducing the losses of energy use. And he actually found out that people are doing it a lot. They're doing the stupidest things and actually just keeping the door open. And he thought that, you know, well, while, let's say, energy efficiency of products is actually reducing, it's becoming better over time, the potential of improvements could be up to be one-third of the total energy consumption, you know, the potential based on looking at behavior. And how much do we gain then? Well, there are several statements about this. And I invite my colleague Edgar Hedwig, and we collaborate a lot, to make these calculations, right? I'm not sure if it's true, but they say, well, if you look at the amount of energy that could be saved by trying to design a water kettle in a way that you don't overfill it, and there has been a lot of design solutions for that, by the way, you might actually save enough electricity to run all the street lighting in the UK for a year. For me, that sounds a little bit, you know, fishy. I'm not sure if that's true. I'm skeptic there. But a lot of these statements are made, so there must be some truth in it. And at least for us, that is a reason and a motivation to look at these things more specifically. And what we do then often is to look at this spectrum. We try to figure out, you know, you have to understand the field. And if you look at the spectrum and you look, for example, on the left, there you see a type of solution, design strategy that informs the user, that gives feedback to the user on his behavior. And an example there is, for example, this. People at NTNU will know this. You know, you find this in the toilets, at least in the male toilets. I'm not sure if that happens in the female toilets as well. I don't come there. But it tells you, it informs you that it might be enough to only use one sheet of paper to dry your hands, and not more. But you can still choose, of course, to take as many as you want, at least as long as nobody's looking, you know. We all know this from hotels. They invite you to keeps your towels for several nights. But still, of course, you can decide to throw, you know, your towels on the floor every day because you want that ultimate luxurious feeling of having a fresh towel every day. If you look up, go up to the scale a little bit, we go to feedback. No, it's not just informing, it's translating your behavior into solutions that are actually informing you about your behavior, like this water meter. But it doesn't influence your behavior physically, you know, you make a conscious choice yourself what to do with it. The same with this. This is called the power, the power aware cord, that's it. The more energy you're consuming, the brighter the cord lights up, which for some people is an eye-opener. For other people, it's a snake that irritates you when you don't want it in your house. It's depending a little bit, you know, on who you're making this for, whether this is going to be a successful solution, yes or no. That's one of the things that we try to investigate. Going up the scale a little bit more, enabling the eco button, which is a way to, if you leave the room, you know, you shut off your PC. You don't have to be afraid that you have to start it all up again and that you lose data. No, it goes back exactly at how you left it, but it reduces the energy consumption while you're away to the absolute minimum. So, great, but still, you can choose not to use it. Then going up is, for example, encouraging. Well, we've seen this picture, so I don't have to explain that anymore. But this is a nice one. It guides you, you know? I don't know why we don't have more of these designs. Of course, you can choose to have your paper there and put it into the opening for the bottles, but why would you? That's extra fuss. You know, design suggests how you should behave, and it makes it very easy. It makes it almost, you know, irritating to do it in the wrong way. Then this toilet button, which was on the first slide, you know, it makes you easy. It persuades you to actually use the small button if you only need a little bit of water. Of course, I mean, you could also call that encouraging or enabling. These categories are not very strict separated. There's some overlap. But let's look at this one, or maybe even this one. This is a better one. It's actually the same principle. It's called the Aware Puzzle Switch. It's also by the Interactive Institute, like the Power Aware Cord in Sweden, that does a lot of this, what they call critical design. Not maybe commercial, because what is commercial? That's another thing that we're interested in terms of research. It works like this. It appeals to our inbuilt desire for order. You know, the left picture means the light is on. The right picture means the light is off. Usually when you leave the building or leave the room, you might not think that the light is on, but they know that it draws our attention. We want order. We want to, you know, make this ugly thing on the left into the nice thing on the right, and by the same time, changing the lights and putting the lights off and saving energy. An interesting picture. It's often used to explain this field. Going up a little bit further, these detergent tablets. They're exactly the right amount of detergent that you need. And of course, you can circumvent this by, you know, trying to break off you know, 1 1/4 and put it in. But why would you? It really steers you in doing the right thing. And then we can go to forcing. This is a situation where you actually cannot. This is designed this way to avoid that you are lying on the bench. This is socially undesirable behavior. You know, that's why they made the gaps in between it. Or you can do it with armrests. This is a design cue, so to say, to make it impossible for you to do the undesired behavior. There are actually this website. It's fun. It says, we have now redesigned our bench to face contemporary urban realities. That's another euphemism for we don't want trams on your benches. Speed bumps, of course you can go as fast as you want, but you ruin your car. So basically it's forcing you to slow down. And then we have automatic examples. For example, this TV with automatic brightness settings. You really don't interact with it anymore. It automatically adjusts the brightness of the television set to the surrounding light, and saving energy that way. So you can see there's a lot of principles that we can use. And some of these examples I've taken from this design with intent inspiration cards made by Dan Lochten, who's a good research colleague of us, and we've done some work with him. He has made, he's collected more than 100 mechanisms, strategies to actually try to suggest ways to realize a certain behavior that you want, sustainable behavior in this case. He has sorted them in 8 different lenses, different perspectives that you could take on a design problem. I was recently part of a workshop at Philips where we played around with this, and it was a lot of fun, and it really opens up your inspiration and your design space, so to say. So I just want to kind of close off with some examples of ongoing research that we are doing right now. Because, well, as I said, this behavior, attention, that has really not played a big role in sustainable design so far. One of the reasons could be that it requires a lot of input from psychologists and sociologists. And we are here at NGNU very fortunate that at the Faculty of Social Sciences and Technology, we have this group, Ripenza, they are environmental psychologists, and they are trained in explaining habits, norms, values, routines, attitudes that people might have towards, well, anything. They haven't had that much experience with applying this into design. They've thought about design. Psychologists have written about scripts and how to try to translate physical things into ways that people interacted with it in a certain way. But a lot of practical work, no, it hasn't been done. So we try to translate this to our type of research. We as designers, we are really good at studying users as well, but usually in relation to products and not so much in relation to behavior, attitudes, routines, habits, and that kind of stuff. So we try to understand how these things can be combined, why you should use a certain method to study a certain thing. I can ask somebody here about their environmental relevant routines in their household, but using a questionnaire probably doesn't help. You have to observe them using video or there's a range of tools that we know from user-centered design that could be helpful. So we try to understand which methods are good for what type of information gathering. We also have to figure out, which design strategies do actually fit what type of design problem. You could design this. This is a typical, it's a great, looks great, but it's a typical engineering perspective on sustainable product design. Yes, you could use the wastewater from your washing machine in order to flush your toilet, but this might not fit in people's routines. They might be afraid that the water goes up from the toilet to the washing machine. You have to study these type of things in order to make this a good solution. And for some it might be, for some it doesn't. But in order to get a company interested, you have to really research this kind of stuff. And talking about that, you really have to study also companies. Of course, it's simple. How to avoid that people use a lot of water in the shower? Well, make sure that they get an electric shock after 2 minutes. But what kind of company would like to have that kind of solution in its product portfolio? Well, I don't think anybody would. So you have to understand who, how to involve companies, how to involve different stakeholders, maybe municipalities, energy suppliers. And that whole system, it's something that I think is important. And to draw that into design is a challenge, because design is sometimes a little bit forward-focused and fuzzy. But this is an important thing in what we try to study as well. And then case studies. We need more case studies. There's so little data. Basically, that refrigerator study is the only one that we know. So we have some projects going on, like with the National Institute for Consumer Research, where we study people, why do they throw away clothes? Why do they wash clothes the way they do? Why do they repair or not repair? And try to translate that kind of information in sustainable clothing design. We have been working with oral healthcare now for a while with Philips, not just, measuring the amount of water that people keep running while they're brushing their teeth. No, we also try to figure out, their morning routines, their attitudes towards clean teeth, why they do it. It's funny, we ask people, why do you clean your teeth? And nobody says, because of good health. No, they're afraid that they smell, basically, So it's funny to understand those things better. One last example maybe is something that we're doing right now. It's together with Senbio, which is the Bioinnovation Center here in Norway. We try to figure out how we can make people to burn wood in a more sustainable way into their houses. If you look at these newspaper headings, you know, Norwegians don't know how to fire. There's actually people dying out of this. Oh, no, there was a Danish newspaper, in fact. But it's funny, we have to try to understand how we should measure these things. And it's just a short anecdote. We said to these people, okay, we can do that. We can analyze people's behavior, attitudes, and stuff like that. And they said, yeah, that's great. We get people into our labs. And then we can observe them how they burn their wood. And then we can measure the emissions from what they do. And that's great. And we can combine the information. And we said, no. You cannot study people in labs. You know, we have to observe them over a longer period of time. In their own situation, and then only you really know what they're doing and how they're doing it. And then they said, yeah, but then we cannot measure the emissions. So they said, okay, so that's an interesting question for research. That's how do we deal with that? How do we, so that's a learning project, so to say, also. Well, I hope I gave you a little bit of an introduction in what design for sustainable behavior is, and why, well, at least we think it's a fascinating research subject. And I would like to thank you for your attention, also on behalf of my PhD students. Thank you.